So we're all doomed. They've stopped saying climate change and they've started saying climate collapse. Everything feels hopeless. I mean, look at Phife. He's devastated. But if you look around, there are signs everywhere that real people are trying to make a difference. Now I know what you're thinking. What we definitely need is another middle-aged white fella telling us what to do. But worry not. In this series, I'm willing to admit that I don't know everything. It's a shocker, I know, on YouTube of all places. But I really don't know everything. So we're gonna go out there and find some actual experts. Executive producer wife, what do we call it?
We call it UsTube.
Gross. And while you wash the smell of that corniness out of your nose, let's cut to some sexy countryside shots and listen to my mate Dan play guitar. Well, that's not an especially creative title, is it? It's just the same name as the channel. But why not start at the beginning?
The year was 2020, just before the pandemic, and executive producer wife got a new job in conservation. She wanted to get people back to nature, so she started working with the Conservation Volunteers, or TCV. One of the best, most accessible activities they run is called balsam bashing. That is the removal of the species Himalayan balsam from our environment. Almost anyone can help out, unless you're a tiny human infant, one of the least capable mammals known to mammals. And if you're watching this, I hope you know. We spoke to executive producer wife to get her feelings on this.
Hi.
You okay?
Yeah, I'm good, I'm good.
Thanks
how are
for
you?
Doing this.
It's no worries, I think it's important to get this done, yeah.
Really appreciate it. As I say, it's not live. You know, if there's any difficult moments, we can stop.
Thank you.
Only answer what you're comfortable with.
Yeah.
So, does it ever feel like he's stealing your ideas?
It does, yeah. And it's quite oppressive, actually. I'm here trying to help the natural world, and he works in an industry that is known to be carbon intensive.
Have you confronted him about this?
No, there's no point. He'll just make you feel like that's his idea anyway.
So, in order to try and make the world a better place, I started balsam bashing too, and it was one of the best ideas I ever had. Oh, hi guys.
Hello.
Weren't you just in that VT that we were looking at a minute ago?
Yeah, that was us.
So, full disclosure, you guys actually work with executive producer wife, is that right?
Yeah.
You're not actually in this scene, do you mind if you just... Okay, thank you. Can I carry on?
Okay.
Sorry.
How are you?
I'm all right, thanks. Would you like some tea?
I'd love some tea. Yeah.
Sorry about the weather. Here we go. Sorry. You take the lid off.
Do you need to?
You're not in this scene. So, guys, where are we and why are we here?
We're at Scour Water Park, and I think we're here to talk about balsam bashing.
That's good. Oh, you got the email then. Right, yeah. So, I, perhaps foolishly, I don't know, want to make a YouTube series about balsam bashing. And I've come to you to ask, what is balsam bashing and why should we do it? What is it?
I'll let Abby go.
Okay. balsam bashing is removing Himalayan balsam because it's an invasive species. And we do it because it can, well, it's invasive, so it can completely cover a whole area, it outcompetes our native plants, and we just don't like it.
It's a bit of a confusing thing, I think, to someone like me who isn't involved in conservation. When I started learning about it, the idea of an invasive species had never even really crossed my mind. This one's especially vigorous. Once you see it, you can't sort of unsee it. It is everywhere, isn't it? But why are invasive species a problem? What's the problem with that?
I think it's just they're just too good. So they're just, like, biodiversity is about, you want lots of different things. You want a mosaic of different habitats, you want variety so that you're supporting as many different species as possible, supporting as much wildlife as possible. But if you get invasive species, they're just so successful that it just becomes just one thing in one space, and that doesn't support as many species, doesn't support as much wildlife, and then then has impacts. Lots of species have lots of different ecosystem services, for example the soil erosion. So if you've got one thing, it only does one thing, whereas if you've got lots of things, they support lots of different things.
Does it work, removing some balsam? Does it work?
It does. It takes a while for it to work. So you could balsam bash in an area 1 year and then go back next year and it would look almost exactly the same, but it wouldn't be. It would be slightly less. Just because there's already seeds in the soil, you might have missed one that then's gone to seed. But if you keep at it for years, you can remove balsam from some areas. Like if you're right by a waterway, it's going to keep coming back, unfortunately. But then places like in a woodland, at one point we did have balsam out of the woodland and Sale Water Park, and then we were all furlowed for a year, so it all came back.
And also the flooding, really? They opened the floodgate. But you've got to be really targeted. So the seeds live in the soil for I think up to 3 years. The soil can stay in the seed bank. And then each plant has 800 seeds. So you've just got to keep on it, and you've got to be quite targeted and specific in what you want for that area. I do know areas, for example, where we've been working, where it's like Hyde Park and Tameside, where they're pretty much on top of the balsam, and it just requires... Okay. It does require a check each year, get rid of a few, but it's nowhere near
in Tameside in Roaches, and we did a section last year that was surrounded by paths, so it was like a nice little patch of woodland separate from anywhere else. So we managed to clear it of balsam. We went back this year, and there was definitely way less. We spent maybe 4 days in it last year. This year we spent half a day clearing the balsam. Amazing. So it was quite a great time. But we'll still go back next year just in case.
But even if you're not getting rid of 100% of it, you're still allowing, even in that year, you're still allowing more light to reach the floor. So even if you're not eradicating it completely, which is really difficult, you're still adding, even by doing a little bit, you're still introducing more light to the floor and allowing more biodiversity that year.
What sort of native plants suffer at the hands of balsam then? When you remove some balsam, what do you want to see come back to its place?
I think it depends.
I
think it depends on the habitat. So, for example, at Sale Water Park, Sale Water Park is a really important habitat for willow tits, which are the fastest declining resident UK bird species. And willow tits want a scrubby, dense, brambly habitat. Willow tits don't actually mind Himalayan balsam; they can live perfectly happily alongside it. But if we were getting rid of Himalayan balsam, we'd want understory trees, we'd want brambles, we'd want scrub, whereas in other places you might be getting rid of balsam for the benefit of wildflowers, so you'd want I'm going to pass over to you for what wildflowers we
might. Thanks. Wildflowers. I don't have a
wildflowers.
Specific wildflower here. Yeah.
There's loads.
But you can see even behind us here, is an area that it's really hard to keep on top of the balsam here because we're in the flood zone of the River Mersey. We're at Sale Water Park. They open the floodgates.
Yep.
All the seeds come in. But
seeds come in on the water?
Yeah, when they open the floodgates along the Mersey, then all the seed bank gets washed into here. Areas where we've been tackling balsam, you can see this year, for example, behind us, I think that's Herb Robert, the pink flower that's behind us there, and just here actually. And last year you wouldn't have had, if you just let that be balsam, you won't have those.
So every little does actually help?
Definitely,
I think so.
Cool. Yeah. You walk down Woodland Pass, you see it on the side, this is how I first encountered it, and I was thinking, what's that? Is this good, is this bad? Is someone just destroying plants? I don't know. But even those little bits do help. Is that fair to say?
I think so. Yeah. If you think every single plant is 800 seeds, so if you get rid of one, you're getting rid of 800 new ones.
That's mad.
Yeah.
That's mad. And they pop these seeds, right?
Yeah. Which is how I discovered them as a kid. I used to pop the seeds.
Right.
Yeah. So great.
Nice that you were in nature as a kid. Yeah. I didn't go further.
It's
than
a lot
the football
of kids
field.
Do it because it is really fun. You see them explode everywhere, and by that point, it's kind of too late to bash them anyway.
Might as well. Okay. So we're not blaming the children.
No.
Okay,
cool.
That's probably for the best. As I say, when I was a kid, it was when I was a teenager, my stepdad at the time said, do you want to go for a walk in the Peak District? And I went, what do you mean, a walk? Is that
for
something
fun?
People do? No. Do you work with kids as well? Do you think encouraging kids to get in touch with the environment is important. What do you think?
We do work a bit with kids. It's not everything we do, but I think engaging young people in things that they care about is important. So I think it's important not to just be like, this is why we're doing it and we care about it. It's important to try and understand what young people care about. But quite often, once they know about something, or I think actually like Balsam Bashing, for example, we've done that with school kids. They just actually really like it because it's quite fun to do, and that's actually kind of like a gateway into some of the bigger issues. And explaining those to them. But a lot of young people are experiencing quite a lot of climate anxiety and worried about things in the world and feeling quite powerless to do it. So actually getting outside and volunteering with TCB or doing this kind of activity is a way to feel a little bit in control of what is very out of our control.
So you do hear that from the kids, do you?
Yes.
The climate anxiety thing. I mean, pretty much the reason we're sat here filming this conversation is that I have a tremendous amount of climate anxiety. I worry about it all the time. I bet you do too. But the younger generation, it's really hard for me to empathise. They have known nothing but it. I think. When we were all a bit younger, it was still a theoretical thing. When you say anxiety, are they scared? Do they chat to you about it?
It was interesting because I interviewed a young person for a project that Ruth was planning. And some of the questions were like, do you experience climate anxiety? And one answer she gave me was that she's worried about her whole future. Like, you can't really plan to get married and have kids because you don't know if the world's going to look the same as it does now. And, you know, she feels guilty for going on holiday or for buying plastic. And it's just constantly the stream of, am I helping? Am I making things worse?
Yeah.
And I think she was really like, she said she's felt it for ages. And
This has been a really nice conversation. Thank you. Could we please do some balsam bashing and you can show me actually how it's done?
Absolutely.
So, guys, do I need like gloves or anything?
It's optional. You can have gloves if you're worried about getting nettle stung or brambled, but you don't have to.
I'm not gonna. So what do I do?
Pull it up. You make sure to get the root out of the ground.
Yeah.
And then I do it slightly different because I snap between this node and the root, but you can just crush it. I like to snap it off.
Oh, that's good.
I find
good.
It a bit more satisfying.
I like that.
And then drop it into a pile, and then you can crush it off later on.
So I'm snapping it right at the bottom there. I quite like that. Yeah, that's lovely. What kind of plants are we sort of bringing more light to here? What are we looking at? I can see red campion here, I think.
I call it pink campion, but yes.
Campion. Yeah. Well, if you call it that, then
I don't know.
There's bramble, which is obviously blackberries. That's pretty good.
And good for wildlife?
Good for wildlife, yeah. Birds eat the blackberries. And
okay.
They have quite a nice flower as well, actually, so pollinators like it too.
You're going to help, Phife? I'm getting stung by nettles, guys.
Yeah, long sleeves, long
sleeves. I am not dressed correctly. What's the best approach then? Because it can feel overwhelming.
Targeted. Yeah, definitely just pick a really small area and then concentrate on doing that really, really well.
Well, look, I realise you do this for a living and you're doing this for the sake of some cameras right now, so I don't want you to do too much more. But now that I know, I'm going to do my best. I'm going to convince as many people to join in. Thank you both very much.
Thank you for helping us here at Selwater Park.
Have we done well here?
You've done great. You've done a great job.
Have I done well?
Yeah.
So what's the point of all this? Well, Phife and I have been chatting and we think it would be amazing if we could make a national pastime out of balsam bashing. In this series, we're going to explore how we can do that, inspired by people like Abby, Ruth, and I suppose others.